Body to this webinar of MTG8 that is dedicated on the diagnosis, the challenging diagnosis of TSHOMAS and RTH beta, resistance to pyroDormone beta. So the conditions of, let's say, central hyperthyroidism. This will be a case-based discussion. I will start by introducing the two conditions, let's say 10-15 minutes of introduction, and then I will pass the discussion of the cases to Irene. We are both Irene Campi, that works together with me here in Milan. We are broadcasting from Milan, and I wish to tell you also that we have built up some last minute questions to ask your opinions on some aspects, on some critical issues. And Irene will ask you to give some opinions by raising your hands in the toolbar of this GoTo meeting system, and you can find your the way to raise your hands, and we will get the opinion or your opinion on the different issues that Irene will raise. So now I will start, and by showing what is the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. We all know that the activity of this axis is mainly governed by the existence of a negative feedback by thyroid hormones, thyroid hormone feedback to hypothalamus and pituitary to inhibit TRH and TSH release, synthesis and release, so to avoid overstimulation or understimulation of the thyroid. And but we also know from several works that the system, the thyroid system, is also governed. There is another way of regulation at the tissue level. We know now that there are transporters, there are the deiodinase system, and you all know that the thyroid hormone that is active in regulating transcription of the target genes is T3, that binds to TRs, TR beta or TR alpha, that are expressed as that are present as homodimers or heterodimers, mainly with RXR, on the promoters of genes that are under the regulation of thyroid by thyroid hormones. And we go into the mechanisms that are involved in abnormal thyroid function, and you can see that classically we have defects in the synthesis of thyroid hormones that can lead to hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, and you can see that hyperthyroidism may be obviously in the large majority of the cases primary, but there are also cases of central hyperthyroidism due to TSH secreting adenomas. Then there are defects in the metabolism and in the action of thyroid hormones, and you can see that we will stick to the presentation of RTH beta, that is in differential diagnosis with TSH secreting adenomas, and mutations in the THRB gene leads to reduced sensitivity in certain tissues, but also to a hyperthyroidism in some other tissues. So we are talking about this condition. In both of the cases, there is a deranged feedback system, either due to the presence of a mutant receptor in RTH beta or presence of a of an adenoma with autonomous TSH secretion in the case of the pituitary TSH secreting adenomas. And in both of these cases, there are elevated thyroid hormones that in several cases similar to the elevation that is seen in the primary hyperthyroidism, but in this case, TSH is not suppressed, and in most of the cases, we have normal or even in some cases, elevated TSH levels, which makes impossible to recognize these cases, these conditions, by measuring only circulating TSH, as foreseen in the reflex TSH strategy that is largely diffused in several settings. We are talking about rare disease. Central hypothyroidism is rare. We know that the frequency of RTH beta ranges from 1 to 20,000 to 50,000 newborns. These are data coming from a source and from the Basque countries, where they retrospectively calculated the frequency of RTH beta by a retrospective analysis of their of the results of the dry blood spot determination of TSH and total T4. Then the TSHomas are even rarer than RTH beta. We estimate to have one TSHoma per 1 million of individuals. So we are talking about rare conditions. In the case of TSHoma, 70% of these tumors are pure TSHomas, but you can see that about 30% of the cases, there is a co-secretion of growth hormone or prolactin, which makes, in some cases, the diagnosis of this disease, of this condition, easier. Thyroid hormone defects due to nuclear receptors. I already mentioned that we have two genes, THRA and THRB, that encode different isoforms. These are the principal ones. And you can see that there is a discrete tissue expression and alternative tissue expression of these two genes. TR beta 2 is the one that is expressed in the pituitary and hypothalamus. So variants that are affecting this isoform can lead to reduced affect the mechanism of negative feedback mechanism, but not the variants that are present in the TR alpha. TR alpha is mostly expressed in the brain, as you all know, and but also in heart and muscle. And this explains, in some cases, explains why some tissues are exposed to high levels of thyroid hormones and they are sensitive to this raised level, can have hyperthyroid manifestation, while other tissues that express mainly beta, like the liver, are more resistant to this elevation of thyroid hormones. We have obviously some genes that are positively regulated by thyroid hormones and that are negatively regulated by thyroid hormones. And thyroid hormones can have can act as activators or repressors of transcription, and this keeps the thyroid system within the required functional limits. diseases of mutations in RTH beta are associated with an autosomal dominant inheritance of these features of elevated thyroid hormones, circulating thyroid hormones, together with goiter. But as you can see in this exemplary family, unsuppressed TSH levels. This is a typical family with a typical mutation in TR beta gene, and there are several single amino acid substitution or small insertion or deletion that results in products with decreased or absent thyroid hormone binding activity or altered binding to cofactors in alternative. And this may produce a dominant negative effect. Now we know that that this negative effect is effectively present, and these are the main studies that initially characterize this phenomenon. And you can see that these studies, there are several mutations here reported down here in the legend under the x-axis, and you can see the results of the percent of inhibition of a repressed thyroid hormone repressed gene, a negatively regulated gene, or the activation of a positive regulated genes. And you can see that the co-transfection of wild-type TR-beta together with mutant TR-beta is associated with an impaired activation or inhibition of these genes. But this defect can be overcome in most of the cases by the addition of elevated concentration of thyroid hormones, which means that this resistance to thyroid hormone action can be overcome by high levels of thyroid hormone, inducing a certain compensation of this defect at the tissue level. We now know that these variants are clustered in three different hotspots within the ligand binding domain, and all these variants are associated with this defect in ligand binding, or at least in activation of the system of the transcription. These are the characteristics of the patients with the biochemical characteristic of the patient with RTH beta, and you can see that they have high levels of 54, high levels of 53, and in the presence of unsuppressed TSH, most of the cases the TSH is within the normal range. And the existence of this elevation of free thyroid hormones together with goiter is probably the result of a secretion of TSH with enhanced bioactivity, a thing that we demonstrated almost 30 years ago in with the bioassay, with an in vitro bioassay. And this is the phenotype of these patients. Some of these patients do not have clear clinical manifestation, but some of them report disorders at the neurological levels with several behavioral disorders, or in some cases mental retardation and learning disabilities that are quite frequent, or speech impediments. Some tissues that are expressed mainly TR beta are also associated with reminiscence of hypothyroidism, tissue hypothyroidism, like the hearing loss that can be present here, or the normal SHBG or the high cholesterol, despite the elevated circulating thyroid hormone levels. And instead, tissues like the heart that express mostly TR-alpha instead of TR-beta, in the presence of these elevated thyroid hormones, there is tachycardia and frequently tachyarrhythmias and sometimes atrial fibrillation, and they can have osteopenia because of the stimulation of bone metabolism by TR-alpha. Esangiomas in most of the cases, already said, highly frequent pure TSA-geomas, but in some cases there can be also mixed forms of TSH-secreting adenomas. At the moment, when we published with Paolo Beck-Pacotz in 1996 an important endocrine and highly cited endocrine review on this topic, 87% of the cases of TSH-geomas were macroadenomas and only 13% were microadenomas. After that, you can see that there is in the tendency to discover, fortunately, these cases at the stage of microadenomas. And this figure is continuously increasing. And in some cases, we also have the possibility, as you will see by one of the cases presented by Irene, that the initial diagnosis was reached when the TSH-secreting adenoma was still not visible at MRI. You can see that we cannot distinguish RTH from TSH-geomas on the basis of circulating thyroid hormone levels, thyroid function test, although TSH-geomas tend to have higher levels than of FT4 than RTH beta patients, at least at the stage of macroadenomas. And during the work that we have done in Milan, but also in other by work of other experts, there will be we have defined some clues that are useful for the differential diagnosis of TSH-geomas from RTH beta. And one important thing is the presence of familial cases in the case of RTH-beta associated obviously with the mutation, germline THR-beta mutation that are inheritable. And the only familial cases of TSH-geomas are reported within the setting of MEN1. There is no mean of differential diagnosis by the determination of thyroid hormones, but you can see that also the finding of a pituitary lesion cannot discriminate always TSH-geoma from RTH because of the presence of incidental lesions, non-functional lesions in cases of RTA in patients with RTH-beta, similar, a frequency similar to that seen in the general population. Other issues that will be discussed during the case presentation by Irene will be the use of parameters of peripheral thyroid hormone action, like the liver parameter SA sex hormone binding globulin or ICTP, that is nowadays more known as CTX, C-terminal procollagen peptide. That is, and these parameters are elevated in TSH-geomas and normal in most of RTH cases. Dynamic testing can also be useful. And one thing that we proposed is the and can be of significant help in the differential diagnosis is the FT4, FT3 reduction or even normalization during a 2-month trial with long-acting somatostatin analog that can be present this reduction only in TSH-secreting adenomas, but not in RTH patients. Obviously, before doing all this testing, we have to exclude conditions that are more frequent than these conditions. And among these, I have to mention mainly the interference in assays, either in TSH, but mainly in FT4, in free thyroid hormone assays, and namely, for example, these alterations in the albumin and the affinity for thyroid hormone binding. And then, but there are several other conditions that can lead to the transient, in most of the cases, finding of high FT4 and FT3 and normal or raised TSH that have to be excluded before reaching the diagnosis of TSH-secreting adenomas or resistance to thyroid hormone. And so this is the flow chart that you have to remind and that will be discussed during the case presentation by Irene. So the finding of high FT4 and FT3 and unsuppressed TSH is the biochemical signature of this condition, which is also named as inappropriate secretion of TSH. When you have this finding, you have to exclude methodological interference. And once that you have excluded the methodological interference that are in most of the cases do not require any other intervention, then you have the case of a central hyperthyroidism, and you have to undergo, in most of the cases, all these determinations, including the genetic analysis, to orient one direction or the others. Why this differential diagnosis is fundamental? Because we have two conditions that require profoundly different treatment approaches. In most of the RTH-beta patients, no treatment is required, but then frequently we have beta blockers or TRIAC that can become useful in certain cases. While in TSH-OMA, the first line treatment is pituitary surgery, and we have long-acting somatostatin analog that are very effective, but also radiotherapy can be useful in some cases to cure this condition. One thing that is common to both conditions is that we have to avoid. The correct diagnosis is very important because we have to avoid in these cases to remove the thyroid. Thyroid ablation in both of the cases is associated with difficult replacements subsequently. We have tissue hypothyroidism in the case of RTH-beta. A rapid increase in goiter volume during MMI can be found, and also pituitary enlargement. And in case of TSH-OMAs, there can be an accelerated tumor growth, reproducing a condition similar to what is seen in the Nelson syndrome in the case of Cushing's disease. So, having said that, I stop here my presentation and I give the floor to Irene. Irene, you can start your presentation.
That I'm going to present is this 60-year-old man presenting with mild symptoms of thyrotoxicosis in spite of very high FT4 level. TSH receptor antibody were positive. The TSH is low but not completely suppressed. And at West thyroid scan, he has an microphone. Very sorry about that. So this patient with this okay. There are some problem of connection in case I can change the laptop. So this patient had a very severe hyperthyroidism with a thyroid scan compatible with autoimmune thyroid disease. TSH receptor antibody were positive, and he had a hypochoic right nodule of 11 millimeters. Since the diagnosis was suspicious of Gray's disease, it was started with metimazole 30 milligram per day. Here are the results of the follow-up, and you can see that the FT3 never normalized during follow-up, while he got a normalization of FT4 only when the TSH was significantly increased. And after 1 year, the echography was checked again, and they decided to perform a cytology. The lesion was compatible with a follicular lesion of undetermined significance. The referral endocrinologist suggests total thyroidectomy, but referred us the patient to exclude resistance to thyroid hormone beta. The daughter had a normal thyroid function test, while the father, who was affected with multinodular goiter, died in 2010, so he was not available for evaluation. So, in this case, which test do you suggest at first? You suggest to go in to some dynamic testing, T3 suppression, or if available in your country, the TRH, or to start directly with the molecular analysis. I think you can raise your hand. So who go for the first option? And who vote for the second? So the majority of the people suggest the molecular analysis, while we start with dynamic testing. So these are the results of the TRH test. You can see that the response of the TSH is flat. Of course, metimazole was discontinued 3 weeks before testing. And the TRH test and controls as an elevation of the TSH following injection, while the curve of the TSH OMA remain flat. And here I have superimposed the data of the patient, so you can see that is very similar to the mean values of TSH OMA patient. So this response might be suggestive of a TSHOMA associated with Graves' disease. And now I'm going to ask which kind of test do you suggest now? To try a second test to be sure of the diagnosis, to directly perform a pituitary MRI, or to start a test with somatostatin analog. So who vote for the first? Now for the second one. Okay. And for the third option. Okay, so the majority suggests the treatment with reduced with an increased testosterone. So this is quite suspicious for inter-serum interference that can be due by biotin, but the patient was not taking anything containing biotin, heterophile antibodies, or paraproteins. So this was really suspicious of interference, and indeed we start to check again every exam after precipitation with pig, and you can see that the reason is that polyethylene glycol is able to precipitate in a specific way any antibodies, so you can remove both paraprotein and heterophilic antibodies. So here you can see that the curve of the TSH now is responsive. The same things occur with prolactin. Testosterone and gonadotropin normalized, while the cortisol now is 8, but you have to consider that the sample was taken after 11 in the morning. And we also check free thyroid hormone. The precipitation is not the best way to treat free thyroid hormone because change the equilibrium, but for this reason, we run in the same experiment also to true hyperthyroidism, and you can see that while in hyperthyroidism FT4 and FT3 remain elevated, normalized in our patient. So to summarize, we had an underestimation of the sandwich immunometric assay, so prolactin, TSH, gonadotropin, and an overestimation of competitive immunometric assays, such as cortisol and free thyroid hormone. The second step was to find the source of this interference. We start with a simple electrophoresis, and we are lucky because we found this huge monoclonal peak of 0.30 gram per deciliter. The patient was sent to the hematologist, and they diagnosed a secondary type cryoglobinemia that was secondary to a indolent B-cell non-Hodgkin lymphoma. On the bone marrow biopsy had only 25% of clonal cells, and no treatment was required in this case. They are just checking every 6 months the blood testing. And this is just to summarize what happened in this patient. So in this case, this blocking, this heterophilic, this paraprotein works as a blocking antibody. So it was interfering with the link of the analyte with the capture antibodies. With the capture antibodies, while the opposite happened with competitive immunoassay. So the cross-link does a sort of sequestration of the analyte, so this causes an overestimation of the results. So, there are any questions regarding this case? If not, we can move to the second. I forgot that. So, of course, he had a suspicious nodule, but then we check again his thyroid scan, and you can see that the nodule is not suspicious, that has not any feature suggestive of a thyroid cancer, but we suggest to give the molecular analysis of this nodule. So we can move to the second case. This is a 50-year-old female presenting with central hyperthyroidism with features of thyrotoxicosis, and she complained about some specific neck discomfort. She was followed in a peripheral hospital, and she was diagnosed as subacute thyroiditis in spite of a normal appearance of the thyroid gland at ultrasound. They start prednisone and beta blockers and triazolam to reduce the symptoms of thyrotoxicosis. This is the follow-up of this patient. You can see that since it was not obviously a subacute thyroiditis, the thyrofunction test didn't change during prednisone. For this reason, the endocrinologist start metimazole, like FT3 and FT4 remain change during treatment, even in treatment with metimazole, but the dose was negligible, so luckily the FT4 and FT3 remain elevated. Then she decided to move to a second hospital, and in this case she was followed by this reflex TSH strategy. In our region, if you require thyrofunction test, they only measure TSH unless you make a special prescription to the patient. In this case, this was not done, so the laboratory gives only the result of the TSH. The metimazole was a little bit titrated over this period, and thyroid West scan was checked again. There was a very mild signs of potentially suggestive for autoimmunity. And then on January 2010, the TSH was normal, and they decided to stop the treatment to reassess in 1 month. Okay, so on September, she repeated the thyrofunction test, and at that point, they found a positive TSH receptor antibodies. She had a worsening, but the TSH was normal, so they concluded for a Graves' disease in remission after withdrawal of metimazole. So on January, had a worsening again of our symptoms. They check again thyrofunction, again just with the TSH. The other investigations were all normal except for a slight increase of the gamma glutamyl transferase. But actually she was obese, so they performed abdomen West scan suggestive of liver steatosis. The patient was upset of her result, and at a certain point she had a dental follow-up, and the dentist referred us the patient to our department. This means that the awareness among endocrinologists about this rare form is still insufficient. These are the exams that we performed at referral. So you can see again the central hyperthyroidism. The thyrofunction test of the relatives was normal, and at that point we can go for further testing. I don't think we have no time to vote, but since she had no other relatives, we have to perform additional testing before molecular analysis. And indeed, we start by the exclusion of interference in the TSH assay. As I said in the previous presentation, we did a dilution test, a PEG precipitation, and a spike and recovery test, all suggestive of a genuine TSH. So this level was not overestimated by some interference. And this is just to summarize the slide already presented by Professor Persani. The dynamic testing show a flat response, so it's quite clear that this is a TSHoma. The central hyperthyroidism was isolated, no other additional secretion were found, and the molecular analysis was negative. We perform also the MEN1 to 4 panel because she had a distant relative affected with acromegaly. These are the results of the imaging. So we found a microadenoma, but she has also an incidental finding of an aneurysm of the internal carotid. So we could not start surgery for the adenoma, but we had to wait because this kind of aneurysm was at risk of rupture. So they decided to perform a stenting, and she need anti-aggregation, dual anti-aggregation for 6 months, and this is a contraindication for pituitary surgery. She was significantly symptomatic, so we decided to treat her with somatostatin analog along with ursodeoxycholic because of the elevated gamma desyltransferase, and you can see a very good response to this treatment. These are the results, are just superimposed to the result of other patients of our groups. So at the last assessment, she was fine. She has no, the treatment was well tolerated. Biochemistry was quite good. Glucose was not significantly increased in spite of chronic treatment. And we also got an improvement of the imaging, and now the lesion is no more recognizable. This is not surprising because, as we said, the treatment is also associated with the mass shrinkage. But now, since she had this good response, now the patient declined surgery, so we are going to keep her on medical treatment. So if there are no questions, we can move to the next presentation. This is a 71 years old female presenting with symptoms of thyrotoxicosis starting in 2006, but it is possible that the diagnosis starts some year before, when she had atrial fibrillation and she was treated with beta blockers and femoral osteoporosis treatment with bisphosphonate and supplementation of calcium and cholecalciferol. Thyroid function test was worsening during the year, and these are the results when she came to our attention. She has also a multinodular goiter with bilateral nodules, not suspicious. And since the thyroid function test was worsening, we suspected a TSHoma, so we start with the pituitary MRI that was negative, with no sign, also without any indirect signs of pituitary adenoma, and thyroid function of the daughter was in the normal range. We measured the peripheral marker of thyroid hormone action. These are the results coming from original publication studying this aspect of RTH and TSHoma, and you can see that the patient has borderline level, but this is not surprising as she was treated with alendronate that reduced the CTX level. We then start with the TRH test. You can see that patient had a small response to this test, but very close to the mean of the response of a TSHoma. This mild response is not surprising. These are all TSHoma, here underlined in blue, that were paradoxically responding to TRH in injection. So we can start with other testing. Of course, we can't perform the T3 for suppression test because fail to suppress after T3 administration, while we get suppression, partial or complete suppression in RTH and normal individual respectively. The T3 suppression test can be combined with TRH to improve its sensitivity, and indeed when we perform a TRH after administration of T3 in we have seen a normal response, again a concerned response. to the RTH, while in normal individual and TSHOMA, the response is not present. So we start we give her somatostatin analog, and you can see that she had a good response, and after 3 months the thyroid function test normalized. So these data confirm the presence of a TSHOMA, although not visible at MRI. This is the follow-up of the patient. The treatment was not very well tolerated. She had a biliary colic and she was at risk of pancreatitis, so they decide to remove the cholecyst. And since she was severely hyperthyroid, we start metimazole to prepare her to surgery. And as expected, since it is a TSHOMA, we had a very large increase of the TSH, but this was something positive in this case, because then when he repeated MRI, we found a small microadenoma. And these are the results of the magnetic resonance of metimazole was able to disclose a macroadenoma. So the contraindication is related to macroadenoma or present that can increase their size. Then we stop any treatment before the surgery, the pituitary surgery, and because we want to evaluate some criteria that are usual to predict response to surgery. And indeed, you can see the patient had a very good prognosis because she had a suppressed TSH 1 week after surgery, but also 3 weeks later. She had the features of central hypothyroidism. So we keep her on follow-up. You can see at 3 months, 6 months, as 9 months, but then we notice something strange. So this is not a central hypothyroidism, while thyroid function test was worsening, and we performed a scintigraphy, and you can see this hot nodule that was causing primary hyperthyroidism. She underwent total thyroidectomy, and these are the results on levothyroxine 3 months after surgery. So we can move to the case. This is a 85 last year's male presenting with hyperthyroidism. So presenting now. Presenting with hyperthyroidism. He has a long history of atrial fibrillation, which was complicated with a stroke in 2010. He has a cardiac, chronic cardiac ischemic disease with 2 previous infarction. He has a monoclonal peak of uncertain significance on follow-up and blood hypertension. Since he was treated with amiodarone since 2017, his GP prescribed thyroid function test. And indeed, he has this severe hyperthyroidism in spite of very few symptoms. But actually, he's quite old. And as you know, in old individuals, sometimes the hyperthyroidism is not so evident. The thyroid scan was compatible with Hashimoto thyroiditis. There was an absent vascularization, and he was diagnosed with a type 2 amiodarone induced thyrotoxicosis. Prednisone was started, and you can see with a very good response. And on months later, he was hypothyroid. Prednisone was escalated up to suspension. And since hypothyroidism was persistent, we start levothyroxine with increasing dose up to micrograms, which is quite an high dose for this patient. It was 2.2 25 microgram per kilos. During this follow-up, he had relapse of the atrial fibrillation and he had acute infusion of amiodarone, and for this reason the cardiologist reduces the dose of levothyroxine, but you can see that with a TSH of 13 he has an inappropriate high level of FT4. So we start the workout of the central hyperthyroidism. So there are several things that we can do. For example, to measure the urinary iodine content, we suspect that this can be a sort of compensation due to a very high low iodine low, to perform a magnetic resonance, or to exclude assay interference, as he had several reasons to have this kind of interference, including this monoclonal peak. But actually, there's no any interference. So the thyroxine binding globulin were normal, transthyretin and albumin sequence was wild type, and PEG precipitation and the dilution test excluded any interference in the TSH. Another option can be an inappropriate treatment with levothyroxine, including poor compliance, but also the presence of amiodarone. Then we check the thyroid function test before the treatment with amiodarone, but you can see that still he has high FT4 level. For this reason, we sequenced the TRH beta gene and we found this variant already associated with RTH beta. But then, surprisingly, we checked the thyroid function test of the brothers. We found that the brother with carrying the same mutation had a normal thyroid function test, although he had some features of RTH, such as multinodular goiter and atrial fibrillation. So how you can explain this discrepant thyroid function test? We know that there are physiological decline of thyroid hormone with age, but also other modifiers. So the two brothers were quite old, so this decline can cause a normalization, a false normalization of the exam, but other modifiers, they were heterozygous for this variant in PDS, and in homozygous, this variant is associated with Prader syndrome, but also autoimmunity, iodine load, or the presence of homocysteine. But we speculate that this was due to a characteristics of this variant. Here is the position, is on the end border of the third hotspot, and you can see that this is an area important for dimerization. And some artificial variant at this codon do not display dominant negative property because there is a lack of dimerization. We have no functional data on the other variant located at this point, but we can imagine that this variant can have a milder feature. As one of this variant that we have recently published in collaboration with Professor Chatterjee, and the family in this case is quite similar to this one. You can see that this is the index case with clinical features of RTH, while the mother submitted to total thyroidectomy had normal thyroid function in some platform and central hyperthyroidism in other, while the brother with normal thyroid function test at baseline failed to suppress with DTSH with increasing dose of LT4. And interestingly, these are the results of the in vitro study. You can see that the impairment of transcription of this mutant tested in vitro was with increasing dose of T3 was only mild affected and was rescued with high dose of T3, and he had no dominant negative effect. While when we studied this variant in another environment, so in an animal model, you can see clearly that the features of the RTH beta, so the region of the alveolar expressive TSH and TG are enlarged, and also the number of follicle producing T4, so suggestive of goiter. And indeed, and in addition, the ability of T3 to suppress the TSH expressing cells was impaired in the mutant. Here in the graph are better represented the quantification of this difference between wild type and this variant. So we can speculate and that this variant can have a similar behavior.
Irene, if you have if you would make a classification, an order of classification, what are the priority the first assay that you would and or clinical findings that you would search in order to make a diagnosis, the differential diagnosis, in order you put them in a ranking order, starting from
so the first step would be to test the other relatives that can help at least to understand how to going on. But we have to keep in mind that, for example, transthyretin and also FDH have a similar dominant and a similar autosomal dominant inheritance. So in our center, we perform NGS and both TBG or transthyretin and the albumin are in the same panel, so this can easily help to distinguish among these condition. If it's available the tandem mass, you can perform this thyroid function test with this method, so this can rule out any kind of interference. But in most of the country, we have still immunometric as first line test. Another thing that we have to do is then start with dynamic testing. I suggest to start, if it's possible, to T3 suppression test, while if the patient is old or has some cardiovascular risk, I think we can also in some cases skip the TRH test and start with the somatostatin analog. Then we can also and then, of course, after we have confirmed the presence of a central hyperthyroidism, we can then perform magnetic resonance.
I'm Diana Grolausen from Aarhus, Denmark. I have questions regarding pregnancy in two young women in my clinic with a thyroid hormone resistance. And my questions, one woman has a positive molecularly testing, and the other is with the other woman, we didn't find her gene defect. The question, they're both fertile and they want to have babies. So the question is for the woman that we know, where we know the gene mutation, would you recommend molecular testing of her fetus when she becomes pregnant, and secondly, whether or not the fetus is affected, and which target level of a free T4 would you recommend?
Vuoi rispondere tu? Do you want to answer, Irene? Or yeah?
If we know that the patient is affected with resistance to thyroid hormone, by routine we don't require the antenatal diagnosis unless we found some feature of thyrotoxicosis in the fetus. And in my experience, often the pregnancy is fine in this patient. I have not observed complication, but sometimes the weight of the neonate of a normal neonate is a little bit reduced. I think it's also depending on the FT4 and FT3 level. If they are much increased, I think you have to check if there are signs of thyrotoxicosis in the fetus. Very often, people with mild resistance normalize their FT4, similarly to what happened in a normal pregnancy, where FT4 sometimes can be a little bit reduced. So unless the patient, the fetus has not features, we don't recommend the antenatal diagnosis. But for example, if the lady is more than 35, she has a risk of other congenital diseases. So very often she did villosynthesis or amniocentesis. So in that case, you can take the DNA from this sample and check the variant. But in my experience, I have not treated with metimazole to reduce thyroid hormone this patient with resistance to thyroid hormone.
Yes, so it depends on the severity of the defect and the elevation of thyroid hormones. If the fetus is carrier of the same variant of the mother, there is nothing, in most of the cases, there is nothing to do. In the case that the fetus is wild type for the mutation, then you are at risk to have some, in some cases, but rarely, to have hyperthyroid feature. There are studies that suggest the possible presence of behavioral disorders in these children after birth, because of, and the severity of hyperthyroid is not that severe. So if the circulating levels in the mother are very are high, you can check the thyroid function by coldocentesis if necessary, or at least check the heart rate and the ultrasound features in the babies, in the fetus.